Why do people aggress? Why do people do things that hurt others or violate the rights of other people? That's a really complex question, and we certainly couldn't answer it in a short video or even an introductory psychology class. But what I want to focus on is just a basic idea that nature and nurture interact to bring about aggressive and antisocial behaviors, or more specifically, biopsychosocial factors interact. And a number of theories have been proposed in terms of the motivation to be aggressive, but what I think really summarizes the field nicely is an article by Terry Moffitt in 1993 titled Adolescent Limited and Life Course Persistent Antisocial Behavior, a Developmental Taxonomy. So Terry Moffitt is basically arguing that when it comes to aggressive behavior and how it develops over time, there's really two categories, hence the idea of a taxonomy. She's trying to organize aggressive behavior or the people who aggress in two different types. And so by understanding her argument, we will get a good understanding of the nature and nurture of aggressive behavior. Okay, so first let's focus on the adolescence limited group. First and foremost, what we should be considering is that this constitutes the majority of the human population. What is it? This is referring to the idea that most people are not really aggressive when they're children. Of course, there's normal children behavior like biting every once in a while or hitting, but that's typical. Most children are not excessively aggressive. Most children are not committing a bunch of crimes. In addition, the same goes for adults. Most adults are not extremely aggressive individuals. However, during adolescence, there is this sort of prototypical, sort of like an experimentation phase that we go through, according to Moffitt, and it's completely normal. In fact, this right here is the FBI crime curve, which shows that the overwhelming majority of arrests occur in the teenage years. Teenagers or adolescents, they're doing most of the antisocial behaviors in our society. Why? What Moffitt tries to argue is that we are driven in adolescence by environmental forces. It's all about the context of being a teenager and an adolescent. So let's consider what she talks about. There's this concept she calls the maturity gap. And what that means is that a teenager is, biologically speaking, an adult. You know, they've already gone through puberty, so they are an adult by biological standards. But a teenager is certainly, or at least typically, not considered an adult in terms of our society's standards. In other words, teenagers, they don't have the same rights. You can't vote until you're 18. You can't gamble. You can't drink alcohol. What else can you not do? You can't rent a car until you're like 25 years old. So our society clearly views adulthood in terms of more social standards compared to biological standards. So the difference there, however, brings about the motivation to sort of act out, to rebel. Adolescents are notorious risk takers. And what Moffitt argues is that they take these excessive risks, they get into trouble, they act aggressively because they're trying to seem more mature in the eyes of their friends. But importantly, this is typical and it goes away once an individual actually attains the standards of adulthood that they crave. In other words, the actual social milestones of adulthood. Moreover, acting aggressively has more severe consequences when you're an adult. So for example, committing a crime after age 18 can actually give you a permanent record. As opposed to when you're under age 18, you might get a simple slap on the wrist. So for various reasons, but all of them being environmental, we are not necessarily going to be very aggressive during adulthood. The same with childhood, but adolescence is this sort of normal period of time to act out. You're, you know, you're figuring yourself out. You're trying to find your identity in a world where, you know, you're biologically an adult, but society doesn't treat you like that. So it's just limited to adolescence. And that's probably why we see this extremely sharp decline in antisocial behavior or crime after the teenage years. However, I'm going to highlight the other group here. The life course persistent group is the group of individuals that are aggressive and antisocial their whole lives. They start off, you know, as extremely aggressive or hostile and antisocial as children, much more than the average child. It continues into adolescence, getting even more severe, and then it persists even further into adulthood. Here's what's important. The life course persistent group only constitutes a minority of individuals within the population. So most people do not fall under this category. But what Moffitt argues is that the life course persistent group is influenced not by environmental forces, but by biological forces. In other words, things like genetics are going to influence the likelihood of these individuals being aggressive and antisocial. And genetics are things that obviously stick with you across your entire lifespan. So that's her argument. Now, is there any evidence that this sort of biological influence on aggressive behavior exists? Absolutely. Researchers are now at the point where we are identifying specific genes that are actually correlated with aggressive behavior. And one of the most well-studied is MAOA, monoamine oxidase A. This is a gene that we all have, but it comes in two polymorphisms, two variations. And we're kind of at this interesting area in research where we're starting to understand that if you have the, let's call it the bad version of MAOA, you have a higher likelihood of being aggressive. So for example, violent criminals are much more likely to have the bad version of this gene compared to nonviolent criminals or even the regular population of people. In animal studies, we have the ability to manipulate genes. In humans, that's still considered unethical. But in rats, for example, if you knock this gene out and sort of switch it to the bad version of MAOA, rats tend to become significantly more aggressive. And then you can knock it back in, you know, turn the gene MAOA into its good version in the succeeding generations, and they return to their sort of average level of aggressive behavior. So in animal research, we know that this gene is important. Now, here's what this sort of speculation seems to be of why this gene would bring about aggressive behavior in humans. This gene, it codes for specific structures in the brain, specifically the amygdala being one important structure. The amygdala is part of our limbic system. The limbic system in general, it processes emotional behaviors, things like fear and aggressive behavior. And some research is showing that depending on which variation of MAOA you have, if you have the bad version, it's possible you might have a smaller amygdala, meaning you might process fear and aggression differently than other people. So just to sort of simplify this, the idea is that we go from genes to brain to behavior. Having that bad version of MAOA might actually bring about a smaller amygdala. Therefore, you can't process fear and aggression the same way. Maybe that makes it easier to be aggressive. Or you can't process empathy because of the way your brain is structured. So if I can't process empathy, it's obviously a lot harder, or a lot, I guess I should say a lot easier to hurt somebody else if I don't feel what they're feeling because of my shrunken limbic system. Now, I guess one thing to add. So what we've seen so far is that this life course persistent group, they're a minority of individuals. They're only a small group, but they have genetic tendencies towards aggressive behavior because of the way our genes bring about the development of specific structures in the brain. But just having the bad gene alone is not going to doom any individual to a life of aggression and antisocial behavior. Essentially, we are the product of epigenetic influences. What that means is that the environment has to influence our genes in terms of the way those genes are expressed. So specifically, one example would be having the bad version of the gene and experiencing abuse early in life, or neglect, for example. So even the biological group, the life course persistent, is still influenced by environment. And so maybe kind of going back to the beginning, the point would be both nature and nurture influence our likelihood of being aggressive. So it's a complex idea. You know, part of it is instinct. We need to survive deadly situations. But another part of it is environmental. There are sociocultural factors that increase the likelihood of being aggressive. All right, so biopsychosocial influences on aggressive behavior.